Anderson Cooper 360, weeknights at 8 and 10 on CNN.
Your co-counsel got some attention yesterday for a knock-knock joke he told as an opening statement. Was that something the two of you had discussed beforehand? What did you think about it?
We had not discussed it beforehand. I think what was really happening, Don has been pretty frustrated with some of what has been going on. I made no bones about the fact that we're very frustrated with the discovery concerns we had with the state, and I think that really frustrated Don. I think this was an attempt by him, to put a little levity in it and to, loosen himself up a little bit because he's carrying some of that frustration with him. I would note that it didn't work the way he wanted it to and probably should have been, rethought.
The state had wanted to have some audio experts, what they said were audio experts, testify saying that on that 911 call, that according to these two audio experts, it was not George Zimmerman's voice yelling for help. Those so-called experts were not allowed to testify because essentially the FBI and others said the science just isn't there yet, the techniques aren't there. That must have been a key ruling for you.
Well, yes and no. Obviously, on the surface, it looks like a very key ruling, but we have to back up a little bit. We had our witnesses, experts, who would say that it was George Zimmerman. So I was not worried about the idea of having a sort of spectrum of experts to say everything across the board. But what we realized once we found out about the case was that no expert could have a firm opinion about whose voice it was. Even two of the state's experts, the two that the state pulled off of their witness list the week before the Frey hearing, those two witnesses said, though they thought it might have been Trayvon Martin on the first scream or two, they believed or thought it was probably George Zimmerman on the last scream or two. So, it sounds as though this is some huge deal for the defense that we kept out this witness against our client. That's absolutely untrue. The evidence that would have come in, had it all come in, would have been across the board. Mr. Owen, who again has the financial interest in his little magic machine, would have said what he said, and even that was only a tendency. And Mr. Reich, who hears things nobody else hears in the universe, was not let in because nobody else could recreate his supposed test. So I would almost have encouraged letting those people in front of a jury just so we could have shown them for who they truly are.
Interesting. How concerned are you about the presence of Trayvon Martin's parents in the courtroom? Several times, because of testimony, graphic pictures, they've gotten up, his mother, his father, today. Apparently jurors are watching that or seeing that. Does that concern you? I know you had wanted the Zimmerman parents, George Zimmerman's parents, to be able to be in the courtroom. They won't be until they have testified.
This is a tragedy for both families. I've said that since literally the first day you and I talked, the first day we've been involved in this case. And the victim's family, Mr. Martin's family, has a right to be in the courtroom. And as long as they act appropriately, that they should stay there. Obviously, there are in-person, there are things that we do that are somewhat insensitive to a family who's lost a loved one. And if they need to leave the courtroom because of that, I'm fine. What I don't want, and I think everyone needs to be careful of, is any type of maneuver or showboating or something that would suggest to try to impact on that jury. So long as they stay away from negative impact on the jury, both the Martin side and the Zimmerman side, then we'll have a good, just verdict based only on the evidence.
It's probably too early to even ask this, and you probably wouldn't answer it even if you did know, but have you planned to have George Zimmerman take the stand?
I've always said that that's a dynamic decision we have to make only once we look at the evidence the state presents. This has always been a case, as every criminal case, where the state has to prove their case. In this case, they have to prove beyond a reasonable doubt not only that the crime was committed and that it was, in fact, a crime, but that George did not do so in self-defense. They have to disprove self-defense beyond a reasonable doubt. If I think that they ever get to that burden, then we might consider whether or not we have to present any case at all.